Hi all, welcome back to Computer Organization course. We'll get started. Today we'll get started with the branch instructions, like how can we execute the branch instructions and in the control sequence how can we represent them. Okay, now what is a branch instruction? So we had already seen an example for this branch instruction in second chapter. If you could remember the instruction branch greater than zero loop, this was there, right? Now this branch greater than zero, it means jump to the location where the statement loop is present. This type of instruction we had seen in the second chapter. Now this branch could be conditional or it could be unconditional. First we'll take example of the unconditional ones. Okay, so in C programming you would come across the unconditional branch statement, such as go to, continue, break, return, etc. So what is a branch instruction? So a branch instruction, it replaces the contents of the program counter with the branch target address. Now this address is usually obtained by adding a offset x, or we call it a constant, which is given in the branch instruction to the updated value of the program counter. Now this figure, what it shows is the control sequence that implements a unconditional branch instruction. Okay, this is a control sequence for unconditional branch instruction. Now how does the processing starts? As usual, it will start with the fetch phase. Now these three steps here, it consists of the fetch phase. So what do you mean by fetch phase? The instruction has to be fetched, right? Which instruction? It is a branch instruction. So the branch instruction is present in the memory and you have to fetch it and move it into the IR. So what will we do? First, we will get the content of the PC, that is program counter. Then we will move it to memory address register. Then a read control signal would be initiated. And in the meanwhile, what will happen? The content of the PC would be incremented to point to the next instruction. Like, how do we do that? We will select 4 in the multiplexer, this control line would be selected. Then we will perform the add operation in the ALU, right? The A operand of the ALU would contain the constant 4 and the B operand would contain the value of PC. Once the addition is done, it would be moved to Z register. From Z register, we will get this in PC and the updated value is again fed into Y register while we are waiting for MFC. So once the MFC is done, memory function complete signal is received, what will happen? The content from the memory, that is the instruction, is fetched and it will be placed in the MDR. From MDR, it would be again sent to IR. So these three things we had seen in the last class, right? So we'll start from the fourth step. Now, the offset value is usually present in your instruction and it is extracted from the instruction register by the instruction decoding circuit, which will also perform the sign extensions if required. Now, sign extensions if required, this means the jump can be either forward or backward. If it is forward, you have to add the offset to the content of PC. If it is backward, then you have to subtract it. Okay. Now, since the updated value of the PC, we already have it in the Y register. Now what will happen? The offset or the constant that has to be added to the updated contents of the PC would be directly moved to the B input of the ALU. So the Y input already has the updated content of PC. Then your B input, it has the offset. Then this would be added and it would be placed in the Z register. So once that is placed in the Z register, it would be moved to the PC. Then this is the end of the instruction. Once the PC has the updated address, what will happen? Again, the execution of the instruction would start. Okay, in the fifth step, it is there. Now, the offset X, it is used in a branch instruction. It is usually the difference between the branch target address and the address immediately following the branch instruction. As shown in this figure, the PC is incremented during the fetch phase here, right? PC is incremented in the fetch phase before knowing the type of the instruction being executed. So once you consider this one, right? So here your PC is updated, but it still doesn't know whether the next instruction is branch or not. So before that only your PC is incremented. So thus what will happen is when the branch address is computed here in the step 4, the PC value used is the updated value, not the old value. Okay, the updated PC value is used, which points to the instruction following the branch instruction in the memory. Now, if you could see here, this offset field of IR out. So this is the constant or the offset which you have to add with the updated contents of the PC. Now, this represents, like till here, it represents the unconditional branch instruction, because we do not have any condition here. That's why this represents a unconditional branch instructions. Now this represents the same, the whatever we have explained, right? It is here. Now how do we represent a conditional branch? Suppose we have an instruction, this one, branch on negative, that is branch less than 0, we have to perform some other task. Then the only changes what would happen is in the step 4. Till here it would remain same, then comes your instruction, that is the branch condition. Okay, so if we consider here branch less than 0, what will happen? So whenever the condition, the register or whatever the value present here is, if it is less than 0, then a branch, a jump would be made. So how do we write it? So this is offset field of IR out, comma add, then comma z in, then we have this condition. Okay, if n is equal to 0, then end. This means whenever n is equal to 0, the processor returns to the step 1 after the step 4. If it is any other value, then the next instruction would be performed. Getting it? You have a quiz now. What does the below control sequence represent? Okay, is it a conditional branch or unconditional branch? You have got 2 minutes of time to respond. Okay, time up. Next, we will study about multiple bus organization. We had already seen single bus organization, right? So now let's check out this three bus organization. So this is nothing but instead of one internal processor bus, we have three buses here, namely bus A, bus B and bus C. Okay, now first, there are some changes here. Let's discuss that one. So we have a register file here, right? So this is nothing but all the general purpose registers which we saw in the single bus organization, right? R0 through Rn-1. Those all are clubbed together in a block called as register file. Okay? Then the register file is said to have three ports. That means Here one input is there and two outputs are there. So what will happen here is, so your three registers can simultaneously work. That means, suppose if we have register R0, R1, R2 and R3, what will happen is, say for example, you can access the content of register R0, then R1, and you can also update the content of R2 simultaneously. Okay, now we have here port A. The port A means the input will be given to, the output will be given to bus A. Port B, this is port B, this is nothing but the output will be given to bus B. And port C, this is nothing but the data from this bus C will be loaded into any of these registers. That means, in the single bus organization, if you want to do these tasks, then we had to do it one by one. But here we can do it simultaneously. Now, the buses A and B are used to transfer the source operands to the A and B inputs of the ALU. Next, we'll study about this one. So the inputs for the ALU can come from this bus A, then bus B, and the output would be sent to the bus C. Here again we have the multiplexer for the input A, wherein it could be a constant 4 or the directly operand from the bus A. Okay. Now, what will happen in ALU? Any arithmetical and logical operation will be performed and the result is transferred to the destination over the bus C. If needed, the ALU may simply pass one of its two input operands unmodified to bus C. This means your ALU, every time it need not do any arithmetic or logical operation, it can also do the passing of the operands. That means, without changing any of the contents from either A or B, it can directly send it to this output, that is bus C. Okay, so we will call this ALU control signals for such operations like unmodified and directly sending it. No changes will be done in ALU. Okay, so we would call them as R is equal to A. Yeah, this is R, right? R is equal to A or R is equal to B. So whenever R is equal to A comes in the instruction control sequence, we should understand that the input A of the ALU is unchanged and is given to the bus C. If R is equal to B, that means the input, whatever it is in the B input of the ALU, it would be again sent to the bus C. Now, why we have this three bus organization is, so this avoids the need of the registers Y and Z as in case of the single bus CPU, right? In the single bus CPU, single bus organization, we had temporary registers like temp, Y and Z. So in this multiple bus organization or three bus organization eliminates the need of those temporary registers. Again, another feature here is the incrementer unit. You can see this one, right? So this is used to increment the contents of the PC by 4. Using this incrementer block separately, what it does is it eliminates the need to add 4, constant 4, to the PC using the ALU. Getting it? So instead of, in the single bus organization, what we used to do, we used to get the input updated value or the PC value in Y register, then we had to update it, like plus 4 we need to do, and then we used to send it back to PC. But here what will happen, the incrementer unit, it will directly add 4 to the contents of the PC. So no need to go to the ALU just for adding the 4 in this organization. But you can still see here the constant 4, right? Now, the source for this constant 4 at the ALU input multiplexer is still useful. It can be used to increment other addresses such as the memory address in load multiple and store multiple instructions. You getting it? So the changes here in the three bus organization are, we have combined all the general purpose register into a single block called as register file. Then we have an incrementer unit which increments the contents of the PC. Then again, this constant 4 is again useful. This comes into picture whenever we have the memory addresses in the load multiple and store multiple instructions. Then Here, ALU, one more special thing about the ALU is it need not, every time it need not do the addition, the arithmetic or logical operations. It can be also used for sending the operands from the input A and B unmodified to the bus C. Okay. The other things remain same, but the working of it will take an example and we'll see it. Okay. So let's consider a three operand instruction, this add R4, R5, R6.
So in this instruction, the contents of R4 and R5 will be added and the result is stored in R6. Now this is the control sequence that is generated, or control sequence for this instruction add R4, R5, R6 for the three bus organization. So what I'll do is I'll compare this with the this three bus organization, and we'll see like how this execution takes place. Okay, so first here understand that the bus A, it has the input from the register file, input from the instruction decoder and MDR, and it has the output going to the MUX. Bus B, it has output from PC, then register file and MDR, and giving input to B, input of ALU. Then bus C, it will give the data to PC, register file, IR, MDR, MAR, and it will take the output from this ALU. So first, if we want to add, okay, it should be R4 here, okay. We are performing this operation, right? Register, add R4, R5, R6. First, what will happen is the execution, where does it begin? It starts with the PC. So what will happen here is the PC content will be given out. That means the contents of the PC will be moved onto the bus B. Okay, now the content is in bus B. It has to be given to MAR, right? But how can you give? From bus B, you cannot directly give to MAR. So what you have to do? Where is the input? So it is here, this line, right? You can see this one, right? This is the only input where from which the bus B can give the data. So whatever the contents of the PC are there, they'll be moved to bus B, and from bus B we have to give the input to the one of the inputs of ALU, that is B input of the ALU. We have to send that. That means suppose if the contents of PC is 1000, then the PC out, what will it do? It will give out the value to the bus B, and from bus B that 1000 value is given to the B input of ALU. Now R is equal to B. What does this mean? That is, the content will not be changed and it is unmodified, and it will be again given to bus C. Okay, after that we have MAR in.
So the output of the bus C should be fed to MAR. So MAR, as MAR is connected, the input of MAR is connected to bus C, we have done R is equal to B and got the PC content in MAR. So once the PC content, that is 1000, is in MAR, what we can do? We can initiate a read signal. So once this is happening, we can increment the pointer program counter. So how do we do that? Directly by using this incrementer block. Okay, need not add constant 4 and all. We can just make use of this INC PC. That means increment PC program counter. Then WMFC signal is given. So WMFC signal, what we understand by this, wait for memory function complete. So once the memory function is completed, that is 1000 has been addressed, pointed, and once the instruction has been fetched, so it will be in the MDR. So from the MDR, where the output of the MDR is connected, it is connected to bus A as well as bus B. But we have to do a addition operation, right? So what we do, instead of bus A, we will consider bus B itself. We'll first do MDR out B, okay? MDR out B, that means whatever the contents of MDR are present, you have to move it to bus B. From bus B, where we have to move? From MDR, what is the usual step? We have to move to instruction decoder, right? So what we do is, again from bus B, the instruction the actual content, that is the instruction add R4, R5, R6 is fed into the B input of ALU, that is R is equal to B, then what will happen? Again, whenever we do R is equal to B, the output will be in the bus C and that will be given to IR. That means right now the instruction or add instruction is in instruction register. So then the instruction would be decoded. Then what will happen? Okay, we have completed till here. We have decoded the instruction. Now we'll understand, your processor will understand that it has to add the contents of R4 and R5. What it will do? This register file contains group of registers, right? R1 through Rn-1. So your R4 and R5 are also present here. What it will do is the contents of the R4 will be read out and it will be moved to bus A. You can see here R4 out A, then R5 out B. The contents of the register R5 would be moved to bus B. Then what will happen? Whatever we have read from the R4, it would be given to MUX. Whatever we have read from the R5, which is on the bus B, would be fed to B input of the ALU. Then what we do? We select, there is a select control line for the MUX. So we will select A. So once we select A, what will happen? Whatever we have read from the bus A would be given to the A input. Then we do a add operation. Once the add operation is done, the sum would be placed on the bus C and the content, the result can be moved to register 6. So this is the end of this instruction. Getting it? Now we'll have a quiz. The question is, in 3-bus organization, all general purpose registers are combined into a single block called as dash. You have 2 minutes of time. Okay, time up. That's it for today. We'll conclude our session. Thank you.